What's been the key to the offensive efficiency the last two games?
I think it's just guys starting to understand what we're trying to do offensively, you know, getting more comfortable, seeing the ball go in a lot more early, just kind of getting into a rhythm, which, you know, I think that the goal is every year to start getting into a rhythm when league play comes around. You want to start playing your best basketball. And I just think that everything, you know, is going our way right now as far as on the offensive end because we put the time in and we're just getting better.
Are you better at the inside-outside game?
Yeah, I think naturally that's just kind of something that Coach Barnes has been preaching to our guys, and we've been wanting to establish ourselves in the inside with our big guys, and that's helped us, you know, make more shots on the perimeter versus, you know, early in the year we had some games where, you know, early in the game we kind of took some open threes, which, you know, weren't terrible shots, but establishing ourselves in the post is always a better thing for us offensively.
What's made Olivier so effective these last five or six games scoring?
You know, Oz is getting more and more comfortable. You know, I think, you know, a lot of times we kind of we kind of don't understand how long it takes to get back in a rhythm of consistently playing basketball. And, you know, this time a year ago, Olivier was playing, and a month later he wasn't. And so all summer it was building that momentum back up and getting the repetition and getting back comfortable with playing a game of basketball. And so now he's settling in and he's starting to look how he looked when he got hurt last year because he was kind of at that pace where he was playing really good basketball at a really high level, really high level. Then he got hurt and it was tough to see. But now I think he's officially gotten back and gotten his rhythm back and he's playing his best basketball I've ever seen. From him, and I saw him in high school. I coached against him one time, and he's a completely different player than that time.
How much of the overall offensive success goes back to the way Zakai is running things right now?
You know, that's been a big thing that we've been focusing on. I personally have been trying to focus on with him. Yesterday, I asked him, "How does it feel to really be a point guard now? Like, how does it feel that you're really learning how to run a team?" And he just started smiling, and I said, "You know, what feels better to you, like throwing a behind-the-back pass with somebody, a dunk, or making a deep three?" And he cut me off, and he was like, "Making behind-the-back pass, like getting other guys' shots." That's starting to be something that feels great to him because he feels like he's creating everything for us. And you know, you look at it in the last two games, he has 18 assists, and he looks like a maestro, man. So I think that his growth is what's allowing our guys to get even better as well. We expect Uros to be Uros, man. We expect him to play really hard. We expect for him to rebound the basketball at a high level. We expect for him to be a facilitator. You know, we expect him to just play his role at the highest level because that was something that got him starters minutes last year and got him in the starting lineup. And early in the year, he had kind of got away from it a little bit. I think he was going through a little bit of an identity crisis. Because all of these guys, man, like, yeah, they're big dudes, but they're kids. They all want to find their worth. When it comes to a high-level team. So he's been trying to find himself when it comes to that, but I'd say lately he's been embracing it, and he's helped Tobey, he's helped Jonas, he's helped O. You know, in practice, those guys have battles, man, like real battles every day. And they all have gotten better gradually through each game. So I think he's handled it the way any veteran or high-caliber team should, honestly.
How much does Josiah being back increase your flexibility in different lineups, what you can play, different ways you can play?
Yeah, Josiah being back is like, I don't like to compare him to this, but it's almost like Kobe back in the Staples Center after a long injury. Like, his energy, his enthusiasm, his infectious personality, it just like lifts everybody. And Jahmai Mashack said last year, after we were going through a rut, we lost to LSU, and Joe was having a bad game. He was, you know, his head was down. He was just in a bad state. I think he was shooting like 19% from the field at the time. And Jahmai was like, "Joe, like, when your head is down and when you're not talking in timeouts, like, it affects us. Like, we don't feel like we could beat anybody when you're like that. But, like, when you have great energy and you're coaching guys up and you're being a leader, like, we feel like we're the best team in the country." And ever since then, I think Joe has embraced how infectious his status is for our guys. Like, him being our leader is important. So with him being back, you know, I don't want anybody to make a mistake and not think that him being back doesn't have anything to do with our offensive success, because it does. He's just another fix-it guy for us, and he fixes everything, whether on the offensive end or the defensive end. He's great at it.
What's that say about Jahmai, a young guy, saying that to a veteran in that situation?
Yeah, Jahmai's always been a guy that's kind of been a younger leader for us, and that's why we're excited for him to take on that role as one of our established leaders next year. But he's kind of already taken that on this year. I mean, I think he's number three in the country in steals percentage. Every time he gets in the game, he's like a Venus flytrap. Like, he just steals passes. He creates havoc defensively. You know, when you think about when we go into games and we have feature scores, you think about who's going to guard him. We have two guys that come off the bench that can literally be takeout guys for anybody that we need to guard. And then we have, you know, three, four guys in our starting lineup that are like that as well. So it's a great luxury to have. And him as a young guy being a catalyst for us defensively, I think is huge, huge.
Did you talk about having a defensive stopper like Jahmai? You played three SEC games, and the leading scorer for the other team has been pretty much taken out.
Right.
This weekend, Jackson obviously went scoreless. What's it say about your kids that they're taking the scout to the floor and executing at that level?
Yeah, just, you know what? They're extremely competitive. And I say all the time, I have so much fun coaching these guys. We have so much fun because it's rare that you have a group of kids that are this competitive and that take on challenges the way that they do. You know, it was a big focus of talking about Gigi, and you know, we went ahead and threw it out there that he had scored in double figures in every game this season. And I was being literal, but not as literal. It's like, hey, like, let's not let him score tonight. Every coach says that. Like, let's not let him score. Hey, he gets nothing. But you don't expect to look at the box score and like, wow, he has 0 points. For a guy that's, you know, potentially going to be a lottery pick. Like, Gigi Jackson's a really good player. But for our guys to step up and take that challenge, I think it just speaks volumes to really the competitive spirit and the championship mindset that we have in the locker room.
How much does it help your defense that you have multiple players that can guard multiple positions?
I mean, it's unreal. It makes us literally like an historic defensive team. Like I said, I don't see a ton of teams in the country that have as many guys that are that high level and that dominant defensively. You know, you go from Zakai Zeigler as a guy that can pick up 94 feet and turn you three times before you get to half court. You got Santi Vescovi, who is one of the most competitive guys I've ever been around. You have Josiah James, who's one of the most versatile defenders you've ever seen, and to me, the best defender in the country, 1-5. Julian Phillips, for a freshman, is a high-level defender, high-level defender. Jahmai Mashack, you know, that goes without saying. Olivier, Jonas Adu. I could throw out every guy on our roster, and it's like, I just get overwhelmed even talking about it. We have so many high-level defenders. It's really a great luxury to have for us.
Let's go two more. What stands out about this Vanderbilt team?
I think Vanderbilt, you know, they lost Scottie Pippen, which, you know, I told Coach that I felt like if Scottie came back, I felt like they were going to be one of the best teams in the league, because last year they were playing their best basketball at the end. We watched them when they really challenged Kentucky at the SEC tournament. And played at a high level. This year, you know, they still play at a super high level. Guys asked me, you know, before the season started, who I felt like was the most underrated coach in this league, and I said Jerry Stackhouse. I think he's an unbelievable coach. He runs great stuff. His teams are tough. They're competitive. They make shots. And since I've been here, at least, the team that puts us in the most in the biggest trick bag defensively is Vanderbilt every year. They get the most wide open shots against us than anybody in the league. And it's partly because of how good of a coach he is.
Any concern about overlooking Vanderbilt and looking ahead to Saturday?
Concern with it? No. It's up to us to kind of make sure that the guys are locked in on what we have to do. At the end of the day, this is a one game at a time process, because we want to win a championship. We want to win a league championship. And we have a checklist after every game that we show guys that has every opponent. And, you know, we put a green check and we highlight the next opponent, and every other opponent is shaded out. So we have to understand that there's no overlooking anybody when it comes to trying to win a championship, because the moment you do that, you lose that opportunity. That's just the bottom line. So keeping our guys locked in on that, luckily we have a mature group that understands, like, we got two games at home this week. That is a lovely scenario in the SEC, and we got to take care of business in each one. But first things first, like, we got to come in here and handle Vanderbilt.
Appreciate you.
Thank you, Coach.
No problem. Thank you. Thank you.